Hello. I mean, because watching you have your eyes closed the whole time and you can tell you're like in deep thought about what your next move is going to be. Where does your mind go when you're exploring improv?
I used to think about the fact that I was performing in front of, I don't know, I was more self-conscious about it. I think closing my eyes just lets me go into my own space and just listening to like whoever I'm with or just playing with myself. I'm just thinking about what is it that I want to say or where do I want to go. I'm kind of thinking about that, but I'm not, I don't know, I guess I'm not exactly sure what I'm.
Yeah.
I'm just thinking about being myself, I guess, and just playing myself.
So you started out playing classical,
yes.
Correct? When did you make the switch to, or when did you start playing jazz? Was there any like people who had influenced you to start?
Yeah, so I would say I moved to Chicago in 2000 for grad school, and I got a degree in classical cello, but 2 summers before I had met a really great flute player who's still playing, Nicole Mitchell. In a classical orchestra, and she kind of talked to me about like, oh, we should try improvising or doing something. I was only there for a summer, so, and then I studied abroad and went back to undergrad at Maryland, and I had a mentor there who was like, you know, you should really try to start doing some more do improvising or just play other styles of music and stuff. And I remember he would give me some Rufus Reed bass lines to read and stuff. So when I did move to Chicago in 2000, I reconnected with Nicole and started playing in her ensembles, and so I kind of got more into improvisation there, because actually the type of things that I do, when I thought about jazz or improvisation, I thought about, you know, tunes and things like that.
Yeah.
So playing with her is kind of where I got introduced to the ACM and thinking about my instrument, timbres and sounds, and thinking of sound landscape as opposed to thinking about harmonic, you know, music that's really harmonically based in that way. But also learning that they can be joined together. It's not like they have to be two separate things, but just exploring more sounds and things of that nature on the instrument.
And so you mentioned that the group that ACM, and you're in a bunch of different groups.
Yes.
How do you manage? Yeah.
It's a lot. I mean, I am an ACM musician. For those of you who don't know, that's the Association for the Advancement of Creative Musicians. But I'm not a part of a formal ensemble with that organization, even though I do play with musicians that are in that organization. For example, just 3 years ago, Nicole, Mike Reed, and I, we played at the Good Shepherd Hall, the Good Shepherd Chapel,
Yeah.
I guess. And that was kind of our tribute to the ACM, because in 2015 they had their 50th anniversary. So we got that ensemble was put together, and basically we play music written by ACM composers. But I don't play in a specific ACM group anymore. But I just play in a lot of different groups. I think that's just a part of, it's kind of a part of it. I was actually just talking to my sister about this morning. It's not like there's one, you know, group that you, I mean, sometimes that works out. You have one group that just works a lot, and so maybe you don't have to play other things. But I actually really love collaborating. I love improvising. So I probably should say no to more things, but I just like playing a lot, and I like learning. I feel like I learn a lot through improvising. So I like playing in lots of different settings. It's just fun for me.
Yeah, I mean, and there's groups that are specifically for like improv, classical, and So how do you approach, when you're working on your own compositions, writing for these different groups?
I mean, I think about, I guess, the instrumentation that I'm dealing with, but I'm just thinking about writing pieces. It's not so much, I guess, well, for my quartet, now that I have a regular lineup, it's like I'm thinking about how Mary's playing guitar, or how Tomo plays, or I'm thinking, or Jason, I'm thinking about their, what I enjoy about their playing, and so sometimes I think about that compositionally, I guess, for that ensemble. But yeah, I guess, I just write things that come to mind. I would say in that group, because I feel like the cello itself is a very versatile instrument, so it could be a solo instrument, it could comp, it can be rhythm, it can be all these different places. So in my quartet, I like to shift the different roles. So it's like sometimes I'm playing the bass line, you know, it's not like,
right.
You know, the bass player has to be the bass because they are the bass. So I really like shifting roles, because that's kind of my experience with my instrument, is that I've, you know, sometimes I'm functioning in the rhythm section, sometimes I'm functioning, you know, as a complement, sometimes I'm out front, so I like making sure that that's all in the music.
That's awesome. So in your education, because you mentioned that you studied classical before you moved here, when did you start making the switch in your education, or did you get the education to do improv and jazz?
Well, let's see. So I graduated with my master's in 2002, and then something I always did is even when I was in school, I played gigs, you know, I was always still doing stuff outside of school, is what I mean to say. And then from 03 to about 11, I was actually a middle school, high school orchestra teacher. And so, but even though I had that full-time gig, I still made sure that I played, I still played a lot of gigs or played a lot of things.
Yeah.
And then I was like, wow, you know, I'm really getting asked to play in a lot of improvised and, you know, jazz context. I felt like maybe I should go back and get a degree in this, and just to learn it more formally. And so that's when in 2009 I took a sabbatical from that teaching job to go and start my doctoral studies at U of I Urbana-Champaign. Because, yeah, I wanted to, you know, for a while I was a little bit on the fence, like, do I like this? How do I, you know, making these weird sounds, is that okay? Like, are people going to think I still play the cello? You know, I just had all these feelings. But I just was drawn to this music, drawn to this particular style or this area of it. So I just kind of went with it. And then when I felt, yeah, like, I think it was really not that long ago, but 2009, I was like, you know, this is my jam. I like doing this. I played in a classical orchestra for a minute, Chicago Sinfonietta. I played in some rock bands, but I think the thing that really spoke to me most was playing this kind of music. Like, I just liked the freedom of it. I liked the history. I really love the history of it. And I liked the stories that I would learn from other musicians around the music. And I'm sure that happens in other genres, but to me it just spoke more, or it just resonated more with me. And so I felt like I wanted to honor it more, so that's why I went back to school to get more information and study it more deeply.
Yeah. When you were in Chicago, was there more cellists who were experimenting with music or playing jazz in that scene?
There is just a few of us. I feel like there might be more now. I feel like when I was coming up, it was Fred Lumbercombe was there, and Harrison Bankhead would play cello. But there wasn't a lot. There weren't very many. Yeah, now there are. I think I feel like there's more now. I have since moved away just a year and a half
ago. Right. And then your teaching, do you plan to go back to teach?
I mean, I enjoy teaching a lot. Right now, so I left that job in 2011 because I was getting a lot more performing opportunities traveling, and I felt like, I guess I say that a lot, like I felt like I should honor this or that, but I felt like I should honor that because a lot of musicians don't get that opportunity to be able to perform their music abroad or to perform, to be given the opportunities that I was being given. So I felt like, you know, while I liked teaching, I felt like I should honor that, you know, the fact that I'm getting offered these opportunities. And so I left that to go and be able to travel. I mean, my motto is have cello, will travel. So I've been doing that, I guess, 7 years now.
And you just came back from overseas very recently.
Yeah.
How was that? What were you?
Let's see. I was playing with Nicole Mitchell. I played with her in her projects. She just had a really great recording that was released on FPE Records entitled Mandrola Awakening. And it was her Black Earth Ensemble. That was, you know, she always has different configurations. So this one was like electric guitar, an oud, a vocalist, poet, a shakuhachi player, taiko drums. The guy played taiko drums, Tatsu Aoki, taiko drums, upright bass, and shamisen, and he made the experimental film that went along with the performance.
That's
yes. Then violin, Nikki played flutes and some electronics, and I played cello and free banjo. So,
so you play banjo?
Kind of. Yeah. I guess I can play tenor banjo.
Oh, okay.
Yeah. So.
Yeah. And where did you go when you were over there?
Oh, we played in that group just did one performance in Stockholm,
okay.
Sweden. And then from there, we went to Halmstad, also in Sweden, and did a trio. Me and Nicole did a trio with Sofia Jernberg, who's a really great vocalist based in Sweden.
Okay.
And then from there, we went to Bergen, Norway, where we played our, actually, even though we've played and I've known each other for about 20 years, we've never actually played as a duo. So we played our first duo gig in Bergen, Norway, and it was really fun. So
that's awesome.
Yeah.
let's see. Oh, so you have your quartet, and can you tell us a little bit about like what you guys have been up to, what you guys are doing, any recordings that you have coming out?
Let's see. Well, we just played the Jazzdopad Festival in Wrocław, Poland. Hopefully I'm pronouncing that correctly. And that was super fun. We were very well received. We have a performance actually this Saturday in Cuyahoga Falls, Ohio. And then we're going to play at Oberlin College. We're going to play at Bucknell. We have some gigs in New York. We're doing, I guess Bang on a Can has a little festival that we're doing. So we have some stuff coming up. We did record the next record, but I've been traveling so much, I need to like pick the tracks and do all the mixing and all that stuff so that can come out.
So do you prefer like more live setting performances or more in the studio?
Definitely live. I like playing. I like the energy that you get from the audience. And I don't know, it's just a weird thing to have a mic. You know, just like, I don't know.
Yeah, the vibe's definitely different.
Yeah, even though, I mean, I feel more comfortable in the studio, but it's just fun to play live shows. I even feel like I listen to way more live music than I do recorded media.
Yeah.
It's just, I don't know, it's just, I like what happens in the moment. That's more exciting to me.
For sure. When you're listening to music, what kind of artists are you listening to? You listen to a lot more experimental or jazz, classical? Like, what do you like to listen to in your free time?
I love Earth, Wind, and Fire. So I still listen to Earth, Wind, and Fire. Actually, just saw them again for like the third time, I think, in August. I don't know. I listen to a lot of stuff. I guess I haven't listened to stuff recently because I've been writing a lot, and sometimes when I'm writing, I don't listen to as much music.
Yeah.
I can't think of anything off the top of my head.
Yeah. Anybody that has been like a big inspiration for you with your music?
Well, Cellistically, I guess I would say Abdul Wadud has been a big hero or influence. He's a really great cello player that played with Jelly Temple. So I always love listening to his solo record by myself. I love Deirdre Murray. I love listening to William Parker. I guess I have this William Parker Billy Banks CD that I've been checking out.
Yeah.
anyone have any questions for Tamika? Trey.
It's important to know the history of what you're doing before. Some people get different entry points into the music. I would say that, like I mentioned, I had a mentor that gave me a bunch of Rivers Reed bass lines that I did work with, but when I did come to Chicago, I feel like my entry point was definitely more through the free realm of things. And again, I mean, I think that's why I went back to school, because I wanted to learn more of what I'm doing, because it's like, I think it's important to have all of that in there, or have awareness of all of that, and then when you play, you just play yourself, you play what you want to play. I didn't grow up in an era where bebop was playing 24/7, so that may not be something that I hear. I always joke that my music has a lot of awesome bass lines, because listening to hip hop, and it's like a lot of repetitive type of movement there. So I just think it's important that we just know our histories in general, and then whatever path you choose is whatever path that you choose. And sometimes it'll come out in your improvisation, and that's cool. But I think you should know it all.
Any other questions? Yeah.
Tamika, do you have an objective in your career? And what achievements so far are you most proud of relating to that objective?
Yeah, I guess I wanted to be performing more regularly and have an international presence. And I feel like I wrote, I want to have a global impact on the cello community. I think I wrote that down in my journal many years ago. And I feel like I'm able to have some kind of impact. I feel like, you know, I mean, there are a lot of improvising cellists, but I want to be a part of that tradition. I want to be part of that legacy. And so I feel like I'm getting those opportunities. I'm able to travel the world or travel around and play my own compositions, leading my own ensembles. So for me, that's a pretty huge achievement for me, or something that I'm very proud of. Yeah, that I'm able to be here and talking to you about my experience. I mean, that's pretty rad. Yeah.
Thanks.
Elizabeth?
Well, I was a side woman for a long And it just so happened that I played in a lot of projects with leaders that were very much about getting their music out there. So I got to travel with those projects a lot. And so I think when it came time for me to debut my own ensemble, people were kind of already familiar with my name, and they were kind of curious about what type of music that I might write. And so I feel like the record was received well, and so then I was given a lot of opportunities to play at various festivals and things like that. So I think just sticking with it, I mean, you know, I mean, James Felzone, I know he played The Velvet as well, and we did lots of gigs where there was definitely more of us on stage than in the audience type of vibe. But we just kept persisting, kept playing. And I think you just keep doing it, keep performing, keep playing in as many groups and different types of styles that you can. And you just never know where those things will lead. You never know who's in the audience that might hear that and wants to bring you somewhere. So yeah, I just think just playing with those different groups and just playing with groups where the leaders, again, were very adamant about getting their music out there. That's how I got my first opportunities to travel abroad.
Nick?
I'm wondering, having worked in a lot of different groups, I'm wondering, particularly in a more improvised kind of setting, how does the way that people communicate in rehearsals and the way that
different styles of band leading? Is that what you mean? Or?
I guess, yeah. I think that has an effect on the sound of the music, ultimately, or the way that the group improvises together.
How does different band leading styles attribute to different performances? Is that what, I'm sorry, if I'm sorry,
I guess, yeah, sure, yeah. Or that, yeah, the way that it ends up coming out or sounding out.
Well, I mean, people have different ways of organizing their rehearsals. I'm not sure if I'm totally understanding how to answer your question or what you're...
I guess I'm just kind of wondering, like, well, I guess here's kind of like my... in a situation when you're not dealing with so many things that are written down, or you're dealing with improvising, you're dealing with, you know, a lot of information, not as much information that's notated, I'm kind of wondering in terms of...
How does a composer communicate that to the?
Yeah, or different. How does different ways of communicating what, or I guess, yeah, in terms of improvising, how does it have an effect in different ways of, I guess, I don't know. Is it not really good?
No, I'm probably really good.
Sorry.
No. Does anybody? Can maybe somebody help me with this or clarify what you might mean?
Like, I just mean like, I don't know. Also say like, in terms of when you just, I guess, different. Different situations that you're working in, different ways that the kind of musical ideas are communicated, you know, within that group about improvising. How are those different ways that people are communicating the ideas? How does that have an effect on sort of the way you think that the music sounds, the way the group interacts in a musical way?
Okay.
I think somebody, I don't know, somebody who really has a very specific thing about here's how I want the improvisation to happen, or somebody that's more open-ended, or somebody that, you know, maybe somebody improvises, and how do those different kinds of things have an effect, you think, on the chemistry musically? Or do they not, maybe at all?
I don't know. How do I communicate with the musicians?
Yeah, like, with different musicians being on
stage. I'm sorry, I'm like,
I mean, I feel like in my experience, like, I don't feel like any of the leaders have been very, okay, that's not true. Most of the leaders I guess I play with are pretty much, I'm sorry if I'm struggling with your question. I feel like they pick people that they, it's like they pick, you have a palette of colors, right? And they're all different colors of pink. So they know that they want to deal with that color palette, but then they let the color palette do what it wants to do, if that makes sense. So it's like, for example, when I played with Nicole Mitchell, when I was first starting out, I was like, she had something specific for the horns and specific for her and specific for the bass and specific for the drums. And I'd be like, what about me? What do I play? And she's like, oh, just kind of figure it out. Like, figure out your part or figure out. And at first it was kind of frustrating because I was just new to the whole thing. So I was like, I don't know what to play. But I think because of that experience, and that's like, I figured out how to fit in. And so I think that's why I comp the way I do, or I do certain things I do, because she just gave me kind of full autonomy to do whatever. And I feel like I've played in other groups where the composer has also given me full autonomy, or given, they trust the musicians. They pick the specific musicians because of the way they improvise. And sometimes they don't know if it's gonna, like, we may have never all improvised together, but they pick them because of they like the different colors that I guess they're gonna bring to this musical painting that's gonna happen. And so, but then they let them do what they do. And then I'm trying to think, because even like with Braxton, he has certain signals and certain things, but he's still giving you, it's just like they're giving you framework, but they're allowing you to do whatever you want in that framework. Is that kind of what you mean?
Yeah.
Sorry.
Did you ever have like a hard time finding your role in this music?
Yeah, I mean, for sure. I have, for sure. But I think it was mostly because I just didn't have a lot of experience. Like sometimes, you know, I hadn't listened to a lot of music, for example, that had two basses in it. So then it'd be like bass and cello, and then they both want us to walk bass lines, and I would think, oh, this feels really muddy or cluttered, but then I was like, then it forced me, like, oh, well, the bass is in this low register, and I'm kind of an octave above, so it forced me to, like, explore walking up in the upper registers of my instrument, so it was like, I feel like some of the challenges, it was more because I was new to it and experienced, and so then it was like, it forced me to, like, figure out different situations. Well, how do I put myself into this mix? How do I find my way in this thing? And I was never, the composer never told me, like, no, that's wrong, or don't do that, or whatever. They let me kind of feel my way and figure out, you know, whatever it is, whatever I wanted to do. And I guess it's been okay, because I don't know. Well, actually, it's interesting. When I was in junior high school, I wrote a lot of music, and then in high school, I kind of just stopped. And then when I went to college, you know, it's very like composition. It means this, and so it was like you have to do this canis firmus and no parallel. And so I was just like, I mean, it's good to know those rules, but then I felt like, oh, I guess I can't write music because I'm not following. But then when I moved to Chicago, part of the ACM and playing with all those groups, they were all like, you need to write your own music, you know, write your own music. And so that's really pushed early on to just be a composer. Because I think through composition, we grow with our improvisation, because you're improvising, and the composition kind of like, the two kind of feed themselves. So then, I don't know, I would just, you know, like, for example, you know, I was like trying to figure out how to play the blues or something, so I would just come up with my own blues melody, and then it just kind of sprout from there. Or I'm inspired by people, so like I've written a piece in tribute to Abdul Wadud, who's one of my heroes, or in tribute to Billy Bang, and Billy Bang really likes pentatonics, so that my piece, when I wrote it, I used pentatonic scales in there just to like, it was a reference to him, even though it was my own song, but it was like a reference to him. But I feel like it was a culture that I was coming out of, definitely in Chicago, that was very much like, don't play tunes, like write your own music, you know, write your own original music. That was very much the norm, a thing that's really prevalent there, at least in the scene that I was involved with.
Any other questions?
Kind of place where you met a bunch of cool people and like kind of
2000, I moved straight to Chicago, so, and I was there for 16 years, so I think I would say Chicago, definitely. I play with an Italian bass player, Silvia Bolognese, and I've met a lot of Italian improvisers, and I really enjoy playing with them as well. So I would say I really enjoy playing with musicians in Italy, like a great vibes player, Pasquale Mira. If you play vibes, you should definitely check, even if you don't play vibes, you should definitely check his music out. There's a lot of great improvisers there. So I would say maybe there as well.
Well, thank you so much.
Thank
for
you.
Today and your show tonight. And then you leave tomorrow night?
Yeah, I play another show tomorrow night.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
Yeah, thank you. Thank you. Thank you all.